Let's talk about evaporation and boiling in this video. Okay, first, let's talk about the similarity of evaporation and boiling. Okay, in this case, I'm doing this video for a primary school audience, but in future, I may do one for upper secondary physics. Okay, so this is for upper primary science. So for upper primary science, I'm going to talk about evaporation and boiling of water. Okay, so for evaporation and boiling of water, what is the main similarity? I guess many of you by now, you have seen my other videos on difference between water vapor and steam. Okay, or I have another video on water cycle and also one on the boiling curve. Okay, I will put the cards. If you are watching this on your computer or even on your phone, I think you will see the cards appearing. Okay, in this corner here, I'll put the cards there. Okay, so if you have learned about the states of water by now, you will know that, okay, for the similarity for evaporation and boiling, it will be the change of state. And what is that? That is water in liquid state turns into water that is in gaseous state. Okay, so there is a change in state from liquid to gas. Okay, so this is the similarity between evaporation and boiling. Next, we are going to look at the differences between evaporation and boiling, and there are a few of them. Let's take a look. Okay, we are going to look at evaporation and boiling of water. Now, we are going to look at the differences. So, these are the differences. Number one. Okay, the first main difference is evaporation occurs at any temperature as long as it's in liquid state. Because we know, okay, earlier the similarity that evaporation and boiling, okay, is a change in state from liquid to gas. So, they must start from a liquid state first. So, at any temperature when water is in liquid state, okay, evaporation can be happening. Alright, however, boiling only occurs at boiling point. And boiling point for water is 100 degrees Celsius. So for water, only at 100 degrees Celsius will boiling be happening. Alright, so that is the first main difference of evaporation and boiling. Now let's move on. For the second point, evaporation only occurs on the surface of the liquid while boiling occurs throughout the liquid. Okay, so for example, let me draw for you. Okay, for example, if I have, okay, two containers of water and one where, this is one of the points that I haven't covered. Okay, I will cover later. One where there's an external heat source. So what happened is when boiling occurs, it means that the liquid throughout, when it reaches 100 degrees Celsius, at any part of the liquid, as long as it's at 100 degrees Celsius and it has enough energy for a change of state to happen, okay, it will start to turn into gas. So that is also another difference that I'll tell you later, that when it starts to turn into gas, what happened? Okay, if this part of the water becomes 100 degrees Celsius and it starts to turn into gas, so what happens if there's gas in the center of the liquid? It forms a space. Okay, and that space, of course, the boundary of the space is the water, so you can see this space, and what we call that is a bubble. Okay, so we will see at any part, okay, the water starts boiling, you see bubble throughout. However, for evaporation only happens at the surface. Okay, so at the top layer, the water particles at the top layer, when they have gain, so you learn right in primary school that gain heat and evaporate. You always say that the water gain heat and evaporate to turn into water vapor. Okay, if you are to explain in full for this change of state for evaporation. So what happened is the top layer gain heat and it is able to escape into the air. So the particle itself on the top layer, it gain heat, it gains enough energy to escape into the air. Okay, so the top layer, the rest cannot, they are all being pressed down by the top layer. Right? How to escape? They don't have enough energy. In boiling, external energy is given. Okay, heat source is there. Okay, let me say it again. For boiling, you have to give it a heat source. okay, so that the temperature can go up to boiling point and then it starts to boil. For evaporation, why is it that it can occur at any temperature? Because as long as the water gains heat, and it can gain it from the environment. For example, after raining, why does the puddle, okay, after raining, there's a lot of puddle. However, what happened is when the sun comes out, okay, the day becomes warm and the environment around this layer of water, top layer, is warmer. So the water cannot gain heat and escape into air. So it evaporates, evaporation occurs. Okay, at any temperature, as long as the water can gain heat from the surrounding and the top layer escape. So top layer escape, lesser water, right? So you know, evaporation slowly, 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 it will evaporate. Okay, the top layer evaporated, then the puddle becomes smaller, then there's still water, right? So they will continue the next top layer. It was the second layer, but now it becomes the top layer, right? Because top layer already evaporated. Okay, so the next layer of water particle now start to evaporate. So, and so on. Okay, so slowly and slowly, it will start to be all evaporated off and the ground will be dry again. Okay, so that is how evaporation occurs when water actually gain heat from the surrounding. So let me come back to this now. Okay, so very quickly, I'm going to show you the rest of the differences now, because after this explanation, I think you have a clearer idea. Okay, so next. Okay, this is one of the differences also for evaporation and boiling. Let me give you another one that I just now mentioned. Okay. Okay, the energy is gained from the environment or the surrounding. So, like from my heating curve video, I have mentioned that for a change of state to happen, the particles have to gain a certain amount of energy. That's why there's a flat. When there's a boiling curve, when there's boiling, there's a flat line. Okay, because the energy is taken in not just to increase temperature, but to actually break the bonds. And okay, when I do the secondary school physics one, you will see more in detail. Okay, it will help the particle to change state, to change into another type from liquid where they are so close together to gas where they are all over in the air and you cannot even see them. All right, so energy. Okay, so gain heat like energy, or I say gain heat from this. You see, I do this. It's no script one. Or from my head. So energy, or you can say, okay, gain heat from environment or surrounding. So whereas here, the energy is from, okay, the energy is from external heat source. Like, so just now the picture I show you. Okay, normally boiling happens only if you put it on a stove, right? Or you have to put it on a hot plate or somewhere. So, you know, there must be an external heat source. You have to supply energy to it. Okay, definitely, because it only happens at 100 degrees Celsius and our environment will not go that high. If it goes that high before the water boils, we are all gone. Okay, so, which is very scary. Yeah, oh dear. Okay, never mind. Let's come back. So, for boiling, it only happens when you give it an external source of energy to help it reach 100 degrees Celsius and let it gain enough energy to change the state. Okay, so that is boiling. And lastly, I have one more. Okay, that is boiling. The liquid stays at a constant temperature of 100 degrees Celsius. But for evaporation, what happened is when the top layer escape, they gain enough heat, enough energy and escape, what is left are water particles of lower energy level, which also is... I think I should do a video on physics. Oh my goodness, I love physics. And yeah, I like to explain physics. So I should do one for you, okay, for my students who are in secondary school. So let's look at this. Stays at constant. For evaporation, what happened is there will be actually a drop in the average temperature of the liquid. Okay, so what happened is, you know, there are questions on why after you come out from the swimming pool, the wind blow, you feel cold. But you know, when you're not inside a swimming pool, came out, if you are not coming out from the swimming pool, you are dry. The same wind, type of wind blow, you don't feel so cold. Why? Because evaporation, what happened, it will take heat away. The water that is evaporating gain heat from you, so you lose heat to the water. And one thing is losing heat. Next, as it lose heat, what happened? Okay, the water left. That means if the top layer, the layers of water on you are gaining heat from you, the top layer gain enough heat to evaporate first. Once the wind blow, they evaporated. The next layer is actually the lesser energetic water particles, they are actually cooler than the top layer. So the average temperature of water left on you is actually now lower. Okay, however, of course, if you explain, I want you to talk about heat gain and heat loss, okay? PSLE, don't tell me all these things. You just say heat is gain, heat is loss. So for evaporation, what happened? What happened to water when evaporation occurred? Water gain heat and evaporates to turn into water vapor. So what happened to you? The water on you is gaining heat from where? From you. So you lose heat to the water. So the water can evaporate and you lose heat. So you are feeling colder. Okay? Okay, I'm interjecting this because I realized I forgot also one more difference which I find is also a very important point which I didn't add in when I was doing the entire video just now. So I want to add this one point. That is, evaporation is a slow process while boiling is a fast process. Okay, which I've also explained earlier with my picture of the powder that, you know, evaporation have to go layer by layer is a much slower process compared to boiling, where the entire liquid, okay, boiling occurs throughout the entire liquid. So that's all for today's video on the difference between evaporation and boiling. I hope that this, you find this enriching and you have learned something from this video. Okay, I will try to make more videos on physics, secondary school physics as well. And also, I am going to start a series of video on electric circuits, which I hope I can help both P6 students as well as lower secondary students. Okay, I won't go too much in depth, so I will go just on parallel circuits and series circuits. And I really hope that my videos can help you. Okay, do come back for more videos. If you think this is helpful, please give it a like. Okay, and if you want to see more and you still have not subscribed to my channel, please consider subscribing. Thank you everyone for watching.